The investigation of Jewish mysticism is one of the most difficult subjects in the field of Jewish studies, and it is therefore no wonder that a long time went by before these inaccessible texts and their obscure background were subjected to serious research, and not only to the roaming of charlatans who were never absent long from this field. Here I shall be able to deal with the subject only, as I said, in the most general way, endeavoring to give you some of the results of the intensive research carried out over the last two generations, although I would rather like to point to some of the still unsolved problems that have been raised by the work done so far and which I cannot do tonight. When I speak of Jewish mysticism, that does not mean, of course, that this kind of mysticism developed the same content, doctrines, or ways of thought as, for instance, Christian or Islamic mysticism. For mysticism is in every religion a later stage of development in which the positive content of a given religion, and this applies especially to the monotheistic religions, is subjected to an internalization, an inward-pointed reinterpretation. Jewish mysticism, then, means a mystical understanding of the world of Judaism and is determined, therefore, by the specific content of this world. It is true, of course, that the mystical experience is a feature common to humanity in general and to all religions, but the most varied phenomena may be observed in the historical patterns in which this fundamental human yearning for religious experience has manifested itself. Thus, one important difference between Jewish and Christian mysticism is a matter that will perhaps serve as a suitable starting point. Jewish mysticism is at the same time esotericism, that is to say, it was a secret doctrine. Not all mysticism is esoteric, and not all esoteric lore is mysticism. Mysticism means a kind of knowledge which by its very nature is incommunicable. It cannot be directly transmitted. It can be made visible only indirectly because its substance cannot be expressed in human language. Esoteric knowledge, on the other hand, means a kind of knowledge that may be communicable and might be communicated, but whose communication is forbidden for whatever reasons. These two possibilities may overlap. It has often been the case in the history of religion that mysticism was at the same time esoteric teaching. It was intended for those few who were to be guided onto the path leading to the experience of the divine. Christian mysticism has hardly ever used the forms of esoteric teaching as a medium of transmission. The element of the esoteric, of the secret oral communication, of the indirectly visible, is not characteristic of Christian mysticism. Here other methods were used, there being sufficient confidence that persons lacking the vocation and liable to misunderstand or to interpret too crudely would not be given access to the most sacred mysteries. Jewish mysticism, on the other hand, was from the first and remained until a rather late period an esoteric doctrine, there being no change in this respect before the great messianic movements of the 17th century and the last great Jewish mystical upheaval, the mystical movement known to us, that of Hasidism, in which forces were at work that abandoned esotericism and appealed to the Jewish public at large. But in olden times and in the Middle Ages, and especially in the main development of Kabbalistic lore, Jewish mysticism was consciously esoteric. It is significant that the mystics of this period, from about 1200 onward, were called Kabbalists, masters of the Kabbalah, where the Hebrew word Kabbalah, which properly denotes merely the handing down of a tradition, was understood in the technical sense of esoteric, secret tradition. Kabbalah is a knowledge that, on the one hand, being mystical knowledge, cannot be communicated, but on the other hand, even insofar as it is communicable, may or should not be communicated except subject to reservations, such as are usually made with regard to initiation into such doctrines. Jewish mysticism is essentially theosophy, that is to say, penetration into the secrets of the world of divinity and of its activity in its connection with the created world and with the riddle of the very existence of this world. Jewish theosophy has a history of its own. And here we come at once to an extremely curious and vitally important fact, one that was altogether overlooked by scholars until our generation. In the history of rabbinic Judaism, that is to say, the Judaism that we know as a great historical phenomenon, mysticism does not, as a majority of scholars formerly assumed, make its appearance in more or less heretical or marginal fringe circles, but it springs from its very heart. An important result of our research has been that this very realization of the oldest Jewish mysticism of Mishnaic and Talmudic times, that is to say the period of the rise of Christianity, was formed not at the fringe of the rabbinic Pharisaic Judaism that was then taking shape, but exactly at its very center. It is in the very circles that most visibly represent this rabbinic Judaism that the history of Jewish mysticism also begins. This means, of course, a considerable change in our estimation of the significance and influence of these phenomena in the history of Judaism. This applies also to the first and second centuries of the Christian era, to the rise of the so-called Merkabah, or throne mysticism, the mysticism of the sphere of the divine throne world, which taught a visionary doctrine of the mysteries of the divine glory and of communion with its manifestations, an esoteric doctrine concerning the divine world and the appearance of God in it and all that is connected therewith, as above all relating to the ecstatic ascent of the soul into this world of the visionary experience of the divine. It was cultivated in the very circle that molded Talmudic Judaism in its most radical exoteric form, as with rabbis Yochanan ben Zakkai and Rabbi Akiba, certainly central figures in the history of rabbinical Judaism. The same holds good for the appearance of the Kabbalah in the Middle Ages. We first encounter Kabbalism as an historical phenomenon in the Jewish world in one of the most important rabbinic families of the Languedoc of Western Provence. From 1150 to 1250, we can follow the rise of the new Kabbalistic mysticism in four generations of one leading family. The first historically identifiable bearers of such tradition were Rabbi Abraham ben Isaac, the president of the rabbinical court of Narbonne, a very ancient Jewish community and an important center of Jewish scholarship, and his son-in-law, Rabbi Abraham ben David, the most famous head of a Talmudic school in his time in Provence, in Poitiers. The latter son, Isaac the Blind, and his grandson, Asher ben David, played an important part in the further history of the early Kabbalah. The role of Isaac the Blind, Yitzhak Saginahor, being even a decisive one. In other words, it was again the learned Talmudic aristocracy and not some anonymous, nameless groups of doubtful Jewish orthodoxy and with meager claims to scholarship that determined the history of these developments. And this holds good as well for the following history of Spanish Kabbalah in the 13th century, where the central figure was at the same time the leading Talmudic authority of Spain in the 13th century, Rabbi Moses ben Nachman, called Nachmanides, whose tremendous authority at the start prevented the criticism, the anti-Kabbalistic polemics which were apt to come up and was only natural to be expected at the time. But against an authority in rabbinic scholarship like Nachmanides, it was very difficult to maintain that there was an heretical teaching conceived there. At the same time, we have the phenomenon, not in Spain and Provence, but in Germany, medieval Germany, in a movement called German Hasidism, Hasidei Ashkenaz in the language of the sources, which took form, which took on the form that we have before us in the writings, above all, of two famous Jewish scholars, Judah Hasid and his disciple Elazar of Worms, who lived at the end of the at the second half of the 12th century and the first quarter of the 13th. There is a similar background to the appearance of Jewish Kabbalah in the second half of the 12th century and in the beginning in Languedoc, that is in the center of the Cathartic heresy in the Catholic Church, one of the most important and most profoundly influential heretical movements experienced by Catholicism in the Middle Ages. The historian clearly cannot be but intrigued by this extremely puzzling and still insufficiently understood connection. The movement of Catharism was at that time at its height, before the beginning of the Great Crusade and the foundation of the Inquisition to fight it, both of which had as an object the fight against the Catharist heresy. This heresy was a revolt against the corruption of the Church as heretics saw it, and aimed at the restoration of the purity of life of primitive Christianity, for which they sought support in ancient Manichaean traditions. At the same time, other movements of that kind were at their height in southern France. And in these two theaters of great historical events, Jewish Kabbalah made its appearance. And who can say what came from within and what from without? What from the sphere of the external history of the persecution of the Jews, and what from the inner stimulation which important figures in contemporary Jewry owed to such movements. The intellectual movement of the Middle Ages transformed the old Judaism. The intellectual movement, neither the rationalist philosophers nor the Kabbalists and mystics can be regarded as still representing the old original Jewish world of Talmudic times, with its unsophisticated attitude to its essential content. That Jewish world, which in spite of all contradictions and tensions, was yet deeply embedded in its original Palestinian, Babylonian, Syrian environment. This new Islamic and Christian environment and the status of Judaism in it produced changes which caused rabbinical Judaism itself to become a problem to its adherents. Both rationalists were far removed from mysticism, and the mystics equally reinterpret the old Judaism. Both endeavor to open up a new dimension in it, one that, while seeming to confirm the old, really transforms it. They accept the rabbinical tradition, but transform it by reinterpreting it. So much is common to all these tendencies, however hostile to one another they may be in other respects. They constitute in a precise sense what could be called ideologies of Judaism, which in them no longer gives naive expression to itself, as in the Midrashic world of the Haggadah, unproblematically and preserving an integral and unreflecting relationship to its subject matter. For the rationalists of the school of Maimonides, Judaism is transformed into a network of allegories. For them, allegory constitutes the conservative, non-revolutionary instrument of critical thought. For in all allegorical interpretation, criticism as a hidden mainspring is also at work. With the help of allegorical interpretation of the meaning of Scripture and of the commandments of the Torah, it was possible to build a bridge on which rabbinical Judaism appeared as an expression popular and planned for the people at large of the same profound truth which had been distilled by purely philosophical means in Aristotle's metaphysics. Allegory makes it possible to relate these two worlds to one another. Such power as Jewish medieval philosophy represents is the power of allegory, and its life is a life of allegory. The mystics, on the other hand, were essentially no allegories. They were, in a precise sense of the word, symbolists. In speaking here of the rise of the world of symbols in the Judaism of the mystics, in contrast to the allegorical world of the rationalists, the distinction I have in mind is the following. The facts referred to by means of allegory may also be expressed in another way. The Greek word allegoria means saying something in another way, in another matter, figuratively. If the truths of religion are allegories, the reason was, in the view of the allegorists, that circumstances of a historical or pedagogical, educational nature provided the motive for such disguise through allegory. The allegorical can always be expressed in another way. It is translatable, may always be related to something to be found in the context of our world. Symbols, in contradistinction, in the exact sense of the word, denote facts that can never be revealed or communicated in themselves, but exclusively by means of other things, other facts through which they may be dimly discerned. Symbols cannot be fully adequately translated. They express something inexpressible, some incapable of being directly communicated by language. Through the symbols of the mystics, we discern, as through a glass, darkly a transcendent world that is beyond the reach of our language. A symbolist in this exact sense, therefore, is someone for whom the reality of the world becomes transparent and who is granted from the reality of things themselves a vision of something which in itself has no expression for us, something that could not appear in its own shape, something divine. The historical process that begins with the appearance of the Kabbalah does indeed accept the reality of rabbinical Judaism, but it transforms it symbolically. If the Kabbalists had not accepted this reality, they would have become heretics, and they were far from being that, at any rate consciously. The world of the Kabbalists is the world of traditional Judaism as transformed by the vision of the symbolists, and it is transformed by this vision no less profoundly then the world of contemporary Judaism was transformed by the philosophical allegorists. We are justified in saying that after the rationalism and the mysticism of the 12th and 13th century, Judaism was never again the same as it had been until then. The process by which this came about is the beginning of the transformation of Judaism, of the rise of a new world of mystical symbols. If you would ask me in one sentence, what is it that the Kabbalism created in Jewish history, I would say they created symbols. That is saying all of it in one sentence. The old words, the old commandments and actions that speak to the Jew and that are imposed on him by the Torah, all these become transparent so that something otherwise, something new appears in them, becomes visible. The most important medium in which this process becomes visible is that of the mystical exegesis of Scripture. The philosophers had interpreted Scripture, as I said, allegorically, in order to build a bridge to the truth of the rational world of the Greeks, of Plato and Aristotle. The mystics found in the Torah, in addition, a light shining in infinite facets, in an infinite wealth of significance, a light that made possible the discovery of new layers of meaning, the symbolic insight into the mysteries of the divine nature. The verbal meaning of the Torah, on which the great Spanish and French Jewish commentators had still worked so intensively in the Middle Ages, is never abrogated. But the words of Scripture become, as I said, transparent to the mystics. Infinite depths open up in them. In every word, innumerable lights appear. Every word has, as I say, 70 faces. And that really means, in Jewish parlance, infinitely many. Thus a conception begins to establish itself, which was to have great importance for the history of Jewish mysticism, namely the notion of infinite wealth of meanings in the divine world. This belief was supported for the religious thought of these times by an overwhelming mass of evidence. If indeed a word of God existed, then it must, in accordance with its nature, be infinitely rich in meanings. The verbal meaning of the Scripture became a kind of glass window through which one could see into the mysteries that became visible in the world as a living communication, symbolic communication of divine revelation. To this must be added a further factor, one of great importance for an understanding of the function of mysticism in the living body of Judaism. It is clear that Jewish mysticism is essentially a mysticism about the Torah, since the Torah is the most important spiritual phenomenon of Judaism. Mysticism here, therefore, is a mysticism concerning the words, the text of the Torah, based on a symbolical extension or conception of the belief in the verbal inspiration, fundamentalism in its most precise sense of Scripture. But it also follows from the nature of the mystical search for communication with the divine that this mysticism should also include an additional field, namely not only the world of the Torah, which can be reinterpreted as giving out a sight into the mysteries of divinity, but the field of prayer. Here, Jewish and Christian mysticism meet in an important point, in spite of the fundamentally different ways in which the mysticism of prayer developed in the two religions. Prayer, I would say, is a natural medium through which the believer communicates with God. And so mystical movements may naturally spring from man's life of prayer. Prayer is directed towards or aimed at something. Hence it is not surprising that we should encounter mystical phenomena in this field. The special significance of Jewish prayer mysticism lies in a factor with which I have to deal briefly here. In rabbinical Judaism, in traditional Judaism, prayer is essentially an activity of the community. Here it is not the individual that speaks or powers out its feeling, but at most the individual as a member of the community. The most important Jewish prayers are about 2,000 years old and date from the time shortly before and shortly after the rise of Christianity. They do not represent the religious effusions of the individual prayer, but express the feeling of the community. We may say, therefore, that these prayers, whose classical texts familiar to the pious Jew, are very clear-cut, simple, and laconic, are a thoroughly unmystical institution. In them, there is expressed the community's recognition of the kingship of God. Individual prayers, though possible, of course, are far from having the religious importance which the communal prayer of the synagogue, of the community, had for the life of these Jews, above all in the diaspora. Hence, the natural pairing of Torah and prayer, which is familiar to Jewish tradition, in them are fulfilled the highest spiritual values known to Judaism. A Spanish rabbi of the 15th century wrote, I quote, "In the Torah, God speaks to man. In prayer, man speaks to God." Jewish mysticism concerns itself with both these ways of what they call speaking. What does it mean God speaks? What does it mean man speaks to God? However, Jewish mysticism approaches the life of prayer in a manner quite different from that of Christian mysticism. In the latter, we have a wealth of mystical prayers and effusions, prayers written for this purpose. But of the Kabbalists of the first periods, it is true to say that they composed very little in the way of prayers of their own in accordance with their specific conceptions of God or in accordance with the symbols, with a symbolic language which they developed. Here and there, such mystical individual prayers have come down to us in manuscripts, but what was decisive in determining the form taken by Jewish mysticism was the transformation of the prayer of the community into a mystical experience of the Kabbalists. The prayer of the mystics uses the traditional text of Jewish communal prayer, but dissolves it by contemplation, by meditation, I would say, rather as the concrete word of the Torah is dissolved here in the infinity of symbolical meanings. The words of the prayer form, as it were, a handrail along which the mystic's meditation feels its way forwards in the prayer, into the depth or heights of the divinity or of the infinite. Just as the mystical exegesis was a means by which the Torah was a seemingly very unmystical text, was transformed into a mystical one, capable of taking on extraordinary dimensions, so what is called in Hebrew kavanah was a means by which prayer was transformed into a mystical process. The Hebrew word kavanah means purpose, precise intention, the concentration of mind on a given object. That is the general meaning of the term kavanah. Thus, for instance, in Talmudic literature, the problem is aired whether the religious commands are to be fulfilled with kavanah, which means that one must concentrate one's thoughts on what one intends to do, or whether if you fulfill the command without thinking of it, as Rasidin used to say, you say the prayer but you think of the stock market. So the problem is it a prayer or is it not a prayer? Hence the sense of kavana is extended to devotion and religious fervor. Now for the Kabbalists, this term means more precisely just this above mentioned transformation of the words in prayer, which make them into symbolic guides for the ascent of the soul into the human being into the world of the divine spheres. Jewish mystics were essentially no ecstatics. For them, it is not ecstasy that is a medium in which the experiences occur. For them, the medium of mystical experience is denoted by the term, by the Hebrew term, devikut, meaning literally adhering or clinging to God. And it should be rendered in the most precise way, perhaps as communion with God, not union with God, but communion. This devikut, adherence to God, is originally a biblical concept, which later was regarded by the mystics as the highest value of contemplative Jewish mysticism. Men cannot, according to this Kabbalistical doctrine, substantially unite with God, but he can enter into intimate communion with him. Some people would say, by definition, that excludes Kabbalah from being mysticism, because only when you unite with God himself, you are a mystic. This is highly debatable, and I would could make a long discourse why I do think that this point of view is erroneous, because mystical experience is reinterpreted by the mystics according to their own tradition. Some traditions think they experience, they have the same experience. Some people call it mystical union, some people reinterpret it as communion. In Judaism, mystical union with God has only very rarely been represented, taught, or maintained as a possibility. To what extent the talk of the Kabbalists and their later followers, the Hasidim, in Poland, in the 18th century, about Vikut, may occasionally also include an experience of mystical union, cannot always be conclusively determined. What is always stressed and represented as the main thing is the living communion, the intimate proximity in which a man knows himself ineffably near the divine, and yet is not fused with it. That thus, in the Vikut, the most intimate thinkable connection with God, short of a mystical union, is thinkable without inconsistency, at least in accordance with its own Jewish presuppositions. Jewish prepositions, the Jewish teaching being of a God transcendent, essentially from every body, every created being, and not mixed up with creation. As I have said, kavana in prayer is connected with this ideal of communion. It transforms every word by giving for every word instructions, technical instructions for meditation, by means of which the word as it were torn open, transformed into a name of God or into a ray of the divine light. Without changing the traditional text, the words of the prayer, the mystical kavanah intention clears away the way of mystical meditation during the moment of prayer, by which the old fixed form of prayer becomes an individual mystical process and experience in the soul of the individual prayer. For many centuries, the inner life of the Jewish Kabbalists continues to be dominated by this kind of mystical prayer. Even today, there are still in Jerusalem a number of synagogues of people who are called mechavnim, as a name, which that is to say, those who pray with mystical meditations. Here, prayer is a completely inward-directed, contemplative event. There was such a school in Jerusalem, which had a consistent existence throughout 200 years. When I came in more than 50 years ago to Jerusalem, the same school still existed, which had been in an uninterrupted tradition, got down for 200 years in the old city of Jerusalem, the yeshiva of Beit El. And they were considered throughout Oriental Jewry as the highest spiritual center of the Jews in Islamic countries. They attracted people from Yemen, from Bukhara, from Tunis, Morocco, Turkey, and very rarely some European Jew, a Kabbalist from Lithuania, or Galicia or Southern Russia came in and had to change all that he had learned of Kabbalah because he had to study for 7 years the practice of mystical prayer by Kavanah. I've spoken of two central subjects from which mysticism springs and permeates the world of Judaism. In addition to these, there is a third central subject which I have to discuss, namely the theosophical mystical doctrine of God as combining his unity with his vitality. Monotheism constitutes the most precious possession of the Jewish tradition. It is a message of the Torah in a doctrinal way. If it speaks of God, monotheism is the center of Jewish teaching. Hence, the unity of God is clearly one of the subjects that naturally offer themselves for mystical contemplation. The meditations of the mystics on the unity of God produce the special theosophy of Kabbalism. This theosophy is the doctrine speaking of the descent of the hidden God, who as the infinite, ineffable, unknowable, and invisible one is here removed from all human understanding. In the descent of this hidden God into the manifestation of his essence in the 10 primal forces or ultimate causes of his being, in which he manifests himself in creation and as creator. These 10 steps by which the hidden essence of God makes itself manifest in creation are called by the Kabbalists with the term Sefirot, a term taken from an early esoteric text from the Talmudic times, the so-called Book of Creation, Sefer Yetzirah, a text of less than 3,000 words, which is written, is the earliest speculative text written in Hebrew, which we have at this time, written around between sometimes maybe the 3rd century, maybe the 4th century, at latest, I think. In this text, the word Sephirot is still taken literally in the sense of numbers, or to say more precisely, primeval numbers. Not just any number, it's called only the primeval numbers by which creation came into being. The ideal numbers of the Pythagoreans, which in this early text constitute the primal forces of creation. For the Kabbalists, however, the Sephirot are no longer numbers, but the various aspects of the divine life and the stages through which this divine life passes in its manifestation and revelation to the created worlds. The doctrine of divine unity is transformed by the Kabbalists into a theosophy about concerning the depths of divine vitality, of divine life, whose unity is in its dynamism. The hidden God, God in himself, may be spoken about only in negatives. In this, the Kabbalists agree with Maimonides, inasmuch as both were influenced in their theology, though in different ways, by the Neoplatonic tradition. Positive statements about God can be made only about the realm of his emanation or manifestation in these spheres of the 10 Sephirot. The development of Kabbalism saw the formation of a utterly new world of symbols by which the Godhead in its dynamic manifestation could be described. That is the Sephirotic life of God, the highest rank in the hierarchy of being known to the Jewish philosopher of the Middle Ages, was the world of pure forms, which were identified by most Jewish philosophers with what the Bible calls angels. Kabbalistic theosophy, however, opens up a new realm of being, which, though to be grasped only in symbols, stands above this angelic world. This world is not known to the school of Maimonides. There is God and then the created forms of being and whatever goes on. But this realm of which the Kabbalah speaks and which it tries to explore and find reflected in every word of the Torah, in every story of the Torah, as a symbolic description of processes not only going on in this world of history, but in a mysterious world of God's manifestation and creative power. The Kabbalists speculated in all kinds of ways about this connection between this realm of the Sephirot and our created worlds, thus opening the way for many new developments and ideas which have determined the further history of Jewish mysticism. I said that the history, that Kabbalah was a teaching about God and his activities in creation. Now, one of the most central developments of later Kabbalism, of the Kabbalism that came up in the 16th century in Safed, not in Spain, but after the expulsion from Spain in the middle of the second half of the 16th century in Safed in northern Galilee, there was a new development, also not by some fringe circles, but in the very center of Safed, which was then the spiritual center of 16th century Judaism. For whatever very curious reasons, everybody from somewhere came to Safed who was somebody. The most lively agents of Jewish religious life concentrated in this little town, which was near the grave of one of the saints of Kabbalism at the second century Talmudist Rabbi Simon ben Yochai, who was supposed to have written the most important text of Spanish Kabbalism, which was reported, was ascribed to him, and his grave was, which is a historical grave, one of the few historic graves, if you ask me, which we have in Israel. Most of them are more or less and the teaching of this novel departure, I cannot discuss here, where I have to be as short as possible, but I cannot avoid to say a word about one central point of this new Kabbalah. What is God, how is creation possible? That was a question that was answered by the older Kabbalists, by the theory of emanation, of the Sefirot, where God's light flows over into creation from a certain point on, and the worlds are in a constant process of developing out of the light of God. Here, in what we call the Kabbalah of Isaac Luria, the most famous of all later Kabbalists, Yitzhak Luria, who died in 1572, we have a totally new departure of a most paradoxical character, and it shows how tremendous must have been the authority of these Kabbalists, that they could get away with a theory which, if expressed by anybody else, would have certainly declared highly heretical, because it would have been seen as violating the doctrine of God's immutability. God does not change. But the theory of which I want to say some minutes is the theory of Tzimtzum. How is it possible that there is a world if God exists? If God exists, there can be nothing but God, because the infinite is by its very nature everything. How can there be something which is not God? That would imply that why isn't God there? Why is not God? If God is the all comprehensive unity of everything, the real essence of everything. So the answer which was given by Isaac Luria and was taken up and became, through all kind of interpretations, reinterpretations, allegorization, I don't know what else, was an answer quite exciting. He said that, of course, there could be no creation as long as God did not make possible the existence of something which was not God. Because This man obviously was not what we would call a pantheist. Pantheism would always be in the background of emanationist theories, overflowing God's light into, well, is it God, is it not God? But Luria, not being a pantheistic thinker, developed the theory that God concentrated himself, removed himself from something, from a little infinite point within his own being, to make possible the existence of something where God's being was absent. By tzimtzum means in Hebrew to be removed, to be concentrated, but not concentrated to a point, but concentrated away from it in Kabbalistic parlance. And therefore, there was going on a process by which God removed himself from a certain sphere. You may call it a point seen from God, maybe a nothing, but from our point, it is the infinity of all those worlds of which the astronomers talk to us, the infinity of created beings and worlds. This is a process then that is highly problematic. So God is no longer what he was. He moved away. He exiled himself from where he should have been in order to make possible that in this little point, which for us is the infinity of the astronomers' worlds, but from God is just a point, but still something which made possible the existence of something where God would no longer be. Now this is possible only by a movement in God. This movement was the movement of Tzimtzum, by which a certain delicate process took place in God, about which Lurianic Kabbalah developed very subtle speculations. But the idea itself, I say, is highly significant. The existence of a world which would be seeking to be reunited with God is possible only by a process by which God shrinks, as it were, shrinks away from a certain point of, as you call it symbolically, in his being. Therefore, everything, creation takes place in this primeval space, as it's called symbolically, where no longer the essence of God is to be found. The problem is, for these, there's a long theory how things develop in this one little point of our world, seen from God's infinity, and their return to God, which is a task of the Jew in this world. There was a primeval exile of God who went into himself, as the Kabbalists used to say, from himself to himself, thereby leaving some room, as it were, symbolically, for where spiritual and not spiritual things could develop, all the hierarchy of creation. You could say then, well, that's an awful theory. It has a certain logic in it. It explains how creation from nothing was possible, because God made possible the existence of a nothing. That, because otherwise there could be no nothing, because God would be, by his very definition, there could be no nothing. Everything was God. So, in order to be there nothing, there should have been such a process. So some people argued that it was a logical necessity that a theory of Tzimtzum should be accepted by a pious Jew, because otherwise there was no creation, there was only God. So in order to evade the consequence of pantheism, you had to accept the theory that there was some process in God. Maybe we describe it as we like, under in symbolic terms, as a Tzimtzum, which made all this. Now this is one of the most intriguing doctrines of later Kabbalism. And people tried all kind, of course people said to them, well, you are heretics. All Maimonides, all Jewish theology, the Bible says God does not change. What changes is only the sfirot, the certain aspects of God by which we see him, as if he, as it were, he changes, but he cannot change. But you say that he changes, the symptom is a change by which there occurs a shrinkage in God. How is this scandalous? And still the theory survived. It survived by saying, as the Kabbalists always used to say when it came to subtle points of theology, they used the word as it were, in Hebrew kivyachol, kivyachol. God did this as it were. We don't know exactly what the process was, but we call it, we describe it in a symbolical way, a scene in human language with a certain logic of human figures. We use spatial symbols as if there was a room, although we know that God is not a room and nothing like that. But still, the problem, how to understand the mystic, the Kabbalistic doctrine of Tzimtzum, occupied the minds of the great, later great mystics as a central problem to understand the secret of creation. How is it possible that we are there and that we are not God? And they didn't think that we are God. Don't make any fuss about that. So we have here one of the most significant contributions. The Kabbalists contributed to the problems of later Jewish theology. And I'm not, of course, going to into the details of all these later histories. So I think I have discussed some of these main points here and given some indication of the atmosphere in which Jewish mysticism rose to be the force which proved itself in the storms and stresses of Jewish history in a much greater degree than Jewish rational philosophy of the Middle Ages. For it is true to say that Kabbalism has had a great historical impact on Judaism and on Jewish society, to the same extent as Jewish rational philosophy often lost its influence in the times of stress. The Jewish mystics believed that in their symbolic philosophy they could link the real existence of the Jews with the depths of the divine transcendence and of what they considered as the exile of divinity, which is going with all of us. And in this way they acquired an ever-growing importance in the history of Judaism and exerted an influence of which many, many traces remain even to this day. Thank you.